Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer. say Psalm 133 together. Oh, how good and pleasant it is when brethren live together in unity. It is like fine oil upon the head that runs down upon the ear, upon the ear of Aaron, and runs down upon the collar of his robe. It is like the dew of Aaron that falls upon the hills of Sinai. Prepare, O Lord, as your name and blessing, life.
Let them alone. They are blind guides. violence. For out of the heart comes evil intention, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person. But to meet with unwashed hands is not defiled. Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then a Canaanite woman that came to the region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." And she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, that even the dogs with the crumbs that fall from the master's table." And Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done as you wish." And the daughter was healed instantly. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Holy, undivided Trinity, one God. The last part of our reading from the letter of Paul to the church in Rome really summarizes the theme of all of our readings today, and that is, God is merciful to all. The first reading from Genesis has Joseph telling his brothers not to fear retribution because of all the horrible things they did to him. It was God's plan all along, for Egypt was going to experience a long famine, and Joseph could help the Egyptians as well as his own family through that time. As we know, Joseph and his brothers were the foundation of the nation of Israelites. God's mercy spread throughout the land through Joseph. Paul's letter to the church in Rome mentions that the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Despite the disobedience of God's people, God remains steadfast and merciful. No matter how many times we mess up, God will be there for us. The reading from the Gospel of Matthew is a little surprising to me. Jesus does not treat this poor woman very well, and she's only looking for help from Jesus. Perhaps some background information will help us understand Jesus' actions a little bit better. Tyre and Sidon are cities mentioned in the Gospel reading and are located in modern-day Lebanon, just north of Israel. In the time of Jesus, these cities had a very bad reputation. Even though there were a few Jewish towns in the area, it was generally considered to be Gentile. Jews would not feel safe there, and very few people would even dare to go there. It was a place of outcasts and undesirable people, much like the Canaanite woman in our reading. The actions of this woman were very radical. First, she was a woman addressing a man who was not one of her relatives, which was considered unacceptable. Secondly, she was a Canaanite. The Canaanites were the people who occupied the Holy Land before God gave it to the people of Israel. They worshipped Baal and other gods and were considered to be enemies of the God of Israel. Not only her ethnic background of a woman was abhorrent to the Jews, but also her cultural and religious background. Thirdly, she had a daughter who was possessed by a demon. Many people at that time thought that sickness in a family was because they were bad people, and they deserved it. Although it sounds disturbing to us when Jesus called a woman a dog, it was likely how most Jews would have referred to her. So here is a despised woman asking Jesus to cure her daughter. She is bold. She is insistent. She will not stop until her daughter is cured. I think many of us can relate to this. Wouldn't we do the same thing if our child or a loved one were in the same situation and we only thought that there was one hope of a cure? The woman believed that everyone, even she and her daughter, deserved to live a healthy life. Jesus' disciples tried to isolate Jesus from her, telling him to send her away. She was a foreigner, not the type of person who should address Jesus. At first, Jesus agreed. His mission was to the children of Israel, not to the Gentiles. He had to put his energies into redeeming the Jewish people. But the woman would not stop. Silence was not an option, only salvation and healing. She needed for her daughter to be cured. She did not object to mercy being given to the Israelites. She just wanted a little share of that. In his story, Jesus became persuaded by the woman. Her insistence paid off. He listened to her, even though his disciples wanted to send her away. She was considered the other. But after listening to her, Jesus learned about her needs, not as a dog, but as a human being. He changed his mind about her. Jesus revealed God's expansive heart, which includes outcasts and foreigners. I want to make a special note here. Not only was the life of the woman changed, but so was Jesus's. He initially rejected giving her help, concentrating instead on the lost sheep of Israel. The woman persisted, though, and he changed his mind. It's not the first time that God's mind is changed by circumstances. The well-known and perhaps sometimes misinterpreted story of Abraham arguing with God about the fate of Sodom and Gomorrah is a prime example. If God can change God's mind, isn't it a great comfort for us to know that we can do the same? St. David's is no stranger to change. You've all been through a lot. And friends, it's not over yet. We sometimes get hung up on achieving an end goal while ignoring the journey. You have started a new journey, and I am so pleased and happy to join you. My role as interim priest in charge is to help you with the process of calling your new rector. That is the end goal. But we have a wonderful journey to go on together. We are God's church here in Claremont, and our mission is to spread the good news to our neighbors. There are lots of ways to do that, and I'm eager to explore some of them with you. Change is not to be avoided, but rather embraced. As Christians, we've been given a guide to help us along the way, namely the Holy Spirit. I'm confident that we'll make good decisions and make changes when necessary if we open ourselves up to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to us. Sometimes we'll have to move beyond our comfort zones, and that is where our faith will step in to cover the gap. I look forward to knowing all of you better. Your wards, Bessie and I, will be working in the coming weeks and months to determine how best to further God's kingdom here in Claremont. I'm open to hearing suggestions and recommendations at any time. You are all God's beloved people, and I want to hear from you. My work schedule is Wednesday and Thursday all day and half day on Sunday. My email address is pretty easy to remember. It's just priest@stdavidschurch.com. May God continue to support and bless us through this new journey together. Please stand if you are able. Let us say together the Nicene Creed, Foundation of Life.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and as was made a man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
With all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above, for the loving kindness of God, and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Susan, our bishop, and for Kirby, our priest, and for all the clergy and people, in the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Church of England. In our diocese, we pray for the clergy and people of St. David's, San Diego, and the children and teachers of St. David's Preschool. In our military cycle of prayer, we pray for the Marines and sailors of Marine Aircraft Group 39 and Marine Corps Air Station Camp Pendleton. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our president, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this city, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For seasonable weather and for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who travel on land, on water, or in the air, or through outer space, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the aged and infirm, for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all
accepts the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion on us and all who turn to you for help, for you are gracious and mother of souls. And to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have not done. We have not loved you with all our heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we want to amend. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in the world and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins, our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth the glory in all the world. Therefore, in creation, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn, to proclaim the glory of the Lord.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
This is the true bread which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Gifts of God for you, the beloved people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. We send you out to share our community with those members who are in the village on this special time in Virginia.
May we hear the prayers of all of us to take this sacrament to Christ our Church.
May those who receive it from you be strengthened and encouraged in the community we have here. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us of these holy mysteries, that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work of love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, the honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
Good morning. First thing I would like to do is welcome Father Kirby Smith. Going forward, just to be clear, he is our interim priest in charge. Ann and I are very thankful for the ministry advisors since June. We are able to hand this over to Father Kirby. Welcome, guess who's in charge now? But we will continue to support him along with your supporting people. I also would like to welcome Sister Chowdy, who is Kirby Parker.
Gift to go to
He was very hopeful, yes, saved.
When is Tyler Clinton's birthday?
It's on Tuesday, the 22nd. I just wanted to mention briefly about Visible Green Development. Not many people know this, but the administrative cost for the recovery by the Episcopal Church. So 100% of your donation goes toward the intended cause. So please, be generous, and they can really use your support. Not the blessing. May God, who sent the Holy Spirit to rest upon the Holy God at his baptism in the river Jordan, pour out that Spirit.